And so there we go, guys. Chicken tiki marsala with rice and some naan bread with lots of garlic and olive oil.
Lead me far away where I can rest, beneath the shadowy place under your wings. Lead me through the fire and bring the peace. Silence is the enemy. With all my heart.
Take my earphones out. Qigong and meditation is done. It is now about 11 o'clock in the morning, just about to eat my one meal for the day. But I want to tell you something. You know, when we start out our mornings, and I know that I'm not working a typical job, there's time to do meditation and yoga in the morning if we make time. It's amazing what it feels like to do Qigong. And I will include the link below because I am being taught by someone on YouTube. And she is a wonderful teacher. Her name is Mimi. Mimi Coomer, I believe it is. I will leave the link below, and I may have said the name wrong because I'm doing it from memory. But she is an established Qigong teacher and has helped me many, many times over the years to learn to find good energy. What are you doing? What are you doing, huh? Do you know I'm gonna cook some food? Where'd you go? Where did you go? You wanna cook some food? You wanna cook some food with Dad?
Well, guys, as I put my apron on, it's Thursday afternoon. Probably. Well, actually, it's not even afternoon yet. It's 11:30 in the morning, and I've just finished my meal for the day. I started out with a one egg and toast first thing this morning, and then about an hour later, I had a sandwich. That was it. And once I reach a point where I'm full, that's what I have for the day. And I'll probably have some juice. I might have a tea. Some vitamins, that kind of thing, but no more meals at this point. But I am going to plant some good karma for the weekend. I'm going to make tiki masala and some naan bread so that I have food for the weekend, so I don't have to purchase food at the market, and so that my meals are organized for the weekend. So I'm going to make some chicken tiki masala. I'm still eating meat at this moment, but this will be a very simple recipe. I won't include it. I will include the link to where I found it. Both recipes, the naan bread and the tiki masala, both are very delicious. I've made them many times, and it's kind of a staple in my diet. So stay tuned. We'll make the naan first, and then we'll work on the tiki masala, and I'll package it up. We'll have three meals for the weekend. Okay, guys, we're going to make some naan bread because we're going to make some tiki masala and some naan bread today. So we're going to start out with some flour, and I like to measure my flour by the gram. It helps if you can find your scale. So So I like to measure my flour by the gram. So we'll zero that out. It looks like that. So there's 250 grams of flour, or that's 2 cups, I guess. Let's put a little bit of salt. So this is a typical bread recipe, right? Salt and flour. This one varies a little bit because this one includes baking powder. So I'll put some baking powder in there as well. And I just like to fluff it up. There's our dry, right? For the wet too, I like to use grams. And it's only because making bread is all about the ratio between the flour and the water. When you make no knead bread, it's probably around 80%, 82% water compared to 100% flour. This one is more of a 60% mixture, so it makes a bit of more of a doughy substance, and you have to knead this one, but it keeps the ratios right. If you get the ratios right, you're gonna have good bread. So this one has to be 160 grams. Okay, so we're just waiting for that to heat up in the microwave. But really the water should be about the temperature of what you would serve a baby with a baby bottle. So not so hot that it would scald the skin, right? We don't want to get it so hot that we kill the yeast. When we put the yeast in, we want the yeast to be warmed up and activated. But if it gets too warm, it'll actually kill the yeast, right? And we put a little bit of sugar in the water so that we have a little bit for the yeast to eat, right? To grow on. So there's our water. It's pretty warm, so I'm just gonna put the sugar in for now. Just half a teaspoon. Maybe a teaspoon if you want. Traditional active dry yeast. And then I like to mix it up. And then I set the timer. So you can see how the yeast is kind of bubbled up. That's yeast, water, a little bit of sugar. So I like to mix in just a little bit of our dry flour mixture so I can create kind of a real healthy, foamy mixture, just like a sauce. But it helps to mix the yeast really well with everything, right? Now is also a good time to put in a little bit of oil. You don't need to put much in, but just a little bit when you're making naan bread. And you also need to use a little bit of oil when you're kneading it. So put the rest of the flour in. Scrape down the sides. Then I like to use a big spoon. Just mix this together. This should give us our dough. So I like to knead it like this, and it'll start to get sticky. That's what you want. You want it to kind of, it looks lumpy and sticky. Yep. Then you start putting into a little bit of oil on your hands. start working with it by folding it over and over until you get until you get some more consistency to the dough. Then what we're going to do is we're going to let this rise, and then we're going to cut it and form it, let it rise one more time, we're going to roll it out and cook it up. Well, it takes a bit of time, but most of the time is sitting around doing nothing. So I mean, it's the kind of thing that you do in the morning, and by the afternoon you've got some naan bread, right? Okay, so that's the naan bread. There you go. I don't know if I've ever mentioned it, but I do smoke the odd joint. And I remember speaking to the monks that I spoke to and that helped me train. And about marijuana, about that kind of thing, right? And I remember him saying, oh, you know, bad investment, right? Bad investment. I said, oh, why is that? And he said, well, did you smoke one of those joints last Tuesday? And I had to think about it, you know. And I said, I smoke one probably every day, right? So probably I did, right? So I said, yeah, I guess I did. I did smoke one probably that last Tuesday. And he said, well, how many times have you looked back at that act of karma and did it pay you? I mean, it paid us the first time, right? I enjoyed smoking the joint and I felt good. Right? He says, yeah, you were paid once, right? Bad investment. I said, what do you mean? So he said, planting karma is about building a future from the things we're doing in the present, right? Smoking a joint or finding pleasure through taking does not build a future unless it gives us health, right? If it gives us unhealth, it is taking away our future. So he said, a new approach, right? A new approach. He says, treat this world and our environment like it is a pharmacy, right? Have the freedom to be a doctor within this world of your pharmacy, right? But take in what will give you a greater future. Take in what will give you greater health, right? For why are you ingesting things that are giving you less future? Why are you ingesting things that are giving you less health, giving you illness, right? So he said, even look at the example of a tomato plant. Plant the plant in the spring. Water it each day and said, see how beautiful that plant grows as it sprouts new limbs and new leaves. Finally, the little tiny yellow flowers come out. And then tomatoes start to grow, right? And we're watering, we're fertilizing our garden each day, quite enjoying it, drinking our tea, relaxing. And finally, the tomatoes are ready to harvest, and we pick them, and we share some with our friends, and we take some and make tomato sandwiches from them, or salads, or whatever we're doing. Now, he would say, how many times did that act of planting that tomato plant pay you good karma? One time? Or many, 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 many times, right? And still the opportunity to grow more tomatoes, right? With the seeds, right? So it was an ever-expanding, beautiful karmic thing that was created by simply planting a tomato plant. No such thing exists when we plant, when we smoke a joint, right? So that's what we get after about 45 minutes. You see how it's got quite a bit larger, and it's got quite a bit smoother. And we're gonna take that out, we're gonna divide it into six, and then we're gonna roll those up into small balls, and then we're gonna put those aside and rise them again. So just like that. Cut in half. cut it in thirds. So those are our soon to be naan bread. So the first we gotta do is make them into sphere. So we just start taking the corners and balling them all up like that. And then we want to roll them up to the look just like that. Spread them out a little bit. And there are your six naan breads ready to rise a second time. Here's not too much flour on it. And then just as you're going towards the frying pan, get your hands wet and dribble some water in the back. And then on the frying pan, it goes. See that okay? Did you get a look? See, he's puffing up. First one is always a bit of a dud. First one. But it might be hotter than normal because I don't remember topping that way before. That looks pretty good. But I just started to think this morning about something that I was thinking about yesterday that I was taught a long time ago and just really sometimes forget to think about. You know, we are divided in this human race by so many things when you start thinking about it. We're divided by color. We're divided by intelligence, right? We can be divided by countries, like borders, by cities and blocks, by families, right? Even families are a division between humanity. And then there's the division between humans and animals, and all the divisions of animals, you know, whether they're birds or reptiles, the way it goes, right? Life is kind of understood through division. And I remember the monks used to say, we can learn very little by taking things apart, right? Particularly after we have removed them from something else, right? That taking a leaf off a tree and examining it, we're not examining the leaf at all, because the leaf was not a leaf unless the leaf was part of the tree. So we're examining dead things and wondering, well, how things work, right? He would say it's better to examine things by putting them together. Anyone can take something apart, but a wise one is the one who understands how it was put together. And then he began to say, for example, before there were this many countries, there were less countries, right? In fact, at one time, there was the first country. So before that time, there were no countries. So man was not divided by borders at one point in his life, right? Look at all the many colors we come in, right? At one time, there were less colors, right? Each color came in at its specific time, right? For a specific reason, right? And at one time, there was only one color. So at one time, color did not divide us, right? And so it goes, right? At one time, there were less cities. There were less towns. You know, there were less blocks. There were less families, right? So, in fact, there was a time when there was the first family, right? And we were not divided by families or cities or towns or municipalities or whatever we have dividing us from each other. Only one family. And that family came from one parent, set of parents, at some point in our history. There are many sets of parents now, but they all came from one set of parents. So we start to realize that we are really one family. It's not just a concept. That we are all related. We all come from one set of parents, in a sense, right? Even in biology, we can follow that back. You know, what created the human form? But billions and billions of years of evolution, right? Each one going back, you know, so many variations of the original form of life that started at the beginning. But as we go back and realize that at some point there were less variations and less variations and less variations and less variations, we begin to realize that at some point there was simply the beginning of life on this planet. It must have happened somewhere. We had a dead planet and suddenly life started on this planet. So it would have started as a single cell, right? And that single cell would have duplicated by dividing itself and creating two identical cells, right? That is still taking place in biology today. So all life came from a life form that was singular and that would replicate itself to increase in its own volume, right? And then that volume began to differentiate into all the different forms of life we see today, right? But it is the proof that we do live in a system of a single consciousness coming from that single birth of life. And everything else we see around us is simply the extension of that life as it divided itself by cloning and then differentiating, because differentiation brought greater safety in a way, right? By becoming more and more different from each other, it made it easier for us to survive pestilence, for example, that attacked one specific type of being, right? But it does not change the fact that we all came from the same parents. A single cell that divided itself through cloning, right? And then used differentiation to become safe. But we are one single being, in a sense, at its greatest thinking, right? You and I are the expression of the same consciousness, but we have forgotten this. Much like a tree puts out limbs, right? And if that tree has a personality, that personality moves into each limb. But as those limbs take over different spots in the atmosphere and produce leaves and begin to search for sun and water, you know, and nutrition, they could become competitive with each other. One branch being competitive with the next branch, you know, using the same personality to produce the same ways of thinking that are creating conflict. When really, at a greater way of thinking, these limbs could realize that they are all the same personality, you know, expressing a desire to be healthy, but they are all the same being, and that cooperation is the healthiest way to continue, right? To forget that to begin to see that division is an artificial way of seeing things, and the reality is that we are one single being, and that conflict, argument, division is a form of ignorance of what we truly are. So anyways, that's what I was thinking about this morning with my coffee. Today will be an editing day, no doubt. I will do a little bit of walking around for exercise, eat my one meal today, and learn how to plant a little more good karma for this week. We had a great week last week. We're gonna make it a good week this week too. So guys, good morning, and let's have a great day. Bye-bye. Okay, are you ready? Watch out, it's all muddy in here. With all the rain, let's go this way. Are you ready? Come here. Come here. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Here you go. She's gone. I guess you gotta walk with me for a bit. Well, I'd like you to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video. And I encourage you to go to my website, thedancingbuddha.ca, if you're interested in some free Zoom meditation classes that I do Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. And please take a look at my course, Using Meditation to Tune Consciousness. It's found on udemy.com, and I think you'll enjoy some of the interesting videos that I've got there. Thanks again, guys, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.